My name is Nina Dokeva. I work at Wolfram Research, and I'll be talking about effective convex optimization solvers in Wolfram language. You all know since version 12 we have convex optimization functionality in Mathematica, and this year we have been building up on it. So I'll talk about the functionality in version 12 as well as the new functionality that is coming up, and also about all the external libraries that we are using and the plugin method that we just added so that more libraries and solvers can be added. Okay, so a few quick definitions. Convex optimization studies minimizing convex functions over convex sets. More formally, it minimizes convex functions F over these inequalities with convex function inequalities and affine functions equalities. And for convex optimization, we know that every local optimal point is a global optimal point. Okay, so to solve efficiently convex optimization problems, we want to transform them first in a conic optimization form. And this is a form that looks somewhat like linear optimization. But here, instead of linear inequalities, we have the so-called conic linear inequalities. So if we can model a convex function in this form, it can be solved with methods similar to linear optimization, and so they will be solved efficiently. So there are slightly different ways to define the conic optimization problem. It can be defined as minimizing linear objective over the intersection of affine space and the proper cone, which I'll define shortly. Or this can be combined, and in our case, we use this second form, where we have a fine left-hand side, a conic inequality, which I'll explain just now. Okay, so a cone is defined as a subspace of Rn, and if we have a cone X that is in the cone, then the ray from the origin that includes this point will be included in the cone. And there are a few more properties that are necessary to define the proper cone so that we can talk about partial ordering and inequalities. So here are the cones that we have available in Mathematica. Non-negative, norm semidefinite, exponential, dual exponential, and power cone. And these are pretty much enough to model almost all convex optimization problems into conic form. So the nonlinear cone is just the the non-negative quadrant in 2D and the non-negative octant in 3D. And we also say that X, so a vector V, we have vector inequality. Vector V is vector greater or equal than zero if all its elements are greater or equal than zero. Or we can also say that the vector V is an element of this cone, which is the non-negative cone in this case, the non-negative quadrant. Okay, so for the second order cone in 2D, the definition will look like this. This is the definition in Rn, and in 2D it's just the norm of x less or equal than y. So this is the norm cone in 2D, and this is the norm cone in 3D, only it goes to infinity here. For the semi-definite cone, we need to define for semi-definite matrix, and then an element, we have symmetric semi-definite matrix is defined in this way. If we multiply X transpose as X for any vector X, it should be greater or equal than zero. So to illustrate this, we will write a two-dimensional matrix like X, Y, Y, Z. It's symmetric. And we'll plot X, Y, and Z given these properties. So a two-dimensional matrix is semi-definite if these three inequalities are satisfied, so that we can plot this as a cone. And the power and exponential cone are here also plotted, just to have an idea. And maybe I should give a very quick illustration of how we can transform a nonlinear inequality into a conic form. So if we have x squared plus y squared less or equal than 4, this can be written as the norm of xy less or equal than 2. And then this becomes xy2 greater or equal to 0 with respect to the norm cone. Okay, so I won't talk much about modeling this year. In my last year talk, I discussed some transformations from convex to conic form, modeling transformations in more detail. Now I'll just give this one example since it's related to some new functionality that we have. So let's maximize the area of the rectangle such that the perimeter is at most 1. And this is the same as minimizing 1 over the area of the rectangle. And this is a very simple example that can be solved by hand or symbolically. But we want to transform it into a conic optimization form to get some intuition about how this works. So in this case, we need linear objective. And we can obtain that with the following transformation. So h becomes the exponent of x, and w becomes the exponent x e to the power of y. So let's substitute this transformation into the objective and the constraints. And now this is the objective, and these are the constraints. And if we take log of the objective, it will now become a linear function as we want it. Now let's see what to do with the constraints. The second and the third constraints are always satisfied. So we could do this transformation just because H and W were assumed positive. So the only constraint that we need to worry about is the first one. And we will replace it with three different constraints. So first, the first part is less or equal than T1, the second part is less or equal than T2, and the sum of T1 and T2 should be less or equal than 1. And then each of these, the first constraint, we will transform into an exponential cone inequality. So first we'll put 2 on the other side, and then to obtain this form, we'll have x2 equal 1, x1 equal x, and x3 equal t1 over 2. So this is the exponential cone inequality. And to typeset it, we need to write the input form, vector greater or equal, the elements of the cone, and here greater than 0, and the exponential cone here. Okay, so the third inequality is a linear inequality. It can also be written in a canonical form as a matrix time the vector plus another vector. And this becomes the conic optimization form. It has a linear objective and conic linear inequalities. So it can be solved with conic optimization. And just because in this case it uses a solver that has tolerance 10 to the minus 6, it sometimes, if we want more, if we want to improve the tolerance, we can use the tolerance option here, so we get better result, 0.5, 0.5. And once we have X and Y, we can obtain H and W, which were e to the power of X and e to the power of Y, which is the solution of our problem, 1/4 and 1/4.
Can you say what tolerance is? I'm familiar with precision goal and accuracy goal, and it's a question of, you know, whether it's a tolerance in the X values or the objective.
Right, so this varies between different libraries, so it's a little gray area what tolerance is. So it is, in a way, a combination of accuracy and precision, but it's not exactly clear. So the definition between different libraries is, and even if in the different libraries, there is not a very clear definition.
You kind of typically, Stan, you can think of it as how closely the constraints are satisfied. Because we always have a linear objective, so it's linear. Most solvers, it's done in a relative sense, but there's sort of an absolute limit based on the precision. So it is a little fuzzy, but we have tolerance in linear algebra as well.
So before you changed tolerance, if you added 501 with 501, you were just slightly greater than 1. Is that what tolerance permitted?
Yeah,
it's sort of
exactly.
A slight misagreement with the constraint.
Yeah. Okay, so we're adding now a new function, geometric optimization, which can do all of these transforms automatically. And it ends up using linear and exponential cones, just as in this example. And more precisely, here are some definitions from the documentation. So we have a generalized polynomial as the objective, and let's start first with what is a monomial. Here is the definition of monomial. And the polynomial is a sum of monomials with positive constants. And the generalized polynomial is after some of these transformations with polynomials. So we can minimize any polynomial subject to constraints with polynomials and monomials, like this. So even though this is not in general, I mean, when it's defined like this, it's not a convex optimization problem. So after the transformations that I just did in the previous problem, it becomes a convex and even conic optimization problem. So many examples fall in this category, and it's a very... So, for example, we can, here is one generalized polynomial here. So this is a sum of monomials with positive constants 1, and now we take a square of this polynomial. And so we can minimize the length of a diagonal of a rectangle, given some constraints. So many geometric problems are in that form. There are also different problems that can be solved with geometric optimization. For example, if we have an n by n matrix A with non-negative real entries, and we want to find the diagonal matrix so that the similar matrix DA, D inverse, has as small as possible Frobenius norm. Then we'll define the diagonal of the diagonal matrix with D1 to Dn with positive elements Di. And then the entries of D inverse are 1 over D1 and so on. So the similar matrix entries are Aij Di over Dj, which are which can then, so for the Frobenius norm, we need to sum the squares, and this becomes a polynomial.
So the D elements vectors, and that's what constrains D to be positive?
Yeah, so for geometric optimization, we are only talking about, I forgot to mention that, but it's important, we are only talking about positive variables, X. Okay, so in that case, we are minimizing this polynomial. We don't have any constraints here. And geometric optimization can transform this into a convex optimization problem with exponential and linear cons and solve this efficiently. And we can check that the resulting matrix, so when we take D and we multiply the matrix, we can check that the eigenvalues of the original matrix are the same as the eigenvalues of the scaled matrix. So this is indeed a similar matrix. So the result is correct. So another function that we have since version 12 is semi-definite optimization, and the formulation is just, it's similar to conic optimization, but since we are talking about a semi-definite inequality, which means a matrix, on the left-hand side we need to have a matrix instead of vector. So here we have a number of matrices A0 to AK multiplied by the unknown variables X1 to XK, so that we can have a matrix on the left-hand side. And conic inequality with semi-definite matrix. So this is the formulation of semi-definite matrix, and it can include, so semi-definite optimization can solve all the problems from the previous classes. They can be transformed into semi-definite form and solved with semi-definite solvers. And conic optimization can solve all of the previous classes, including problems with exponential and norm cons. Okay, and here is the new function geometric optimization, which can go back to conic optimization using exponential and linear cons. Okay, so the good thing is that all the transformations that are done within these functions can be detected automatically from a general nonlinear, non-convex function like n-minimize and find minimum. So if you give, for example, and minimize a convex problem, it is very likely to detect that it's convex and solve it efficiently. Okay, and something else that is coming in the new version are mixed integer solvers for all of these classes of problems. And mixed integer means that we can have real and integer variables. So here is a problem with real variables, very simple problem with real variables, and here we can request that one of the variables is integer. And this could be solved in previous versions using the CBC library, using linear programming, which became linear optimization. Now the function linear programming still exists, but for consistency, we now call this linear optimization. And conic optimization is calling linear optimization. We also have a commercial solver called MOSIC, for which you can use if you have a MOSIC license. And it can also solve mixed integer problems. So this was for linear problems. For nonlinear problems, again, for nonlinear problems, we have a solver called outer approximation, for which Pareto will talk in a lot of detail today, later this afternoon. So I will just mention that by default, conic optimization calls outer approximation. And the solver MOSIC also can solve mixed integer nonlinear problems. Okay, so here are all the libraries that we're.
We're not planning to ship MOSIC at this point.
Oh, okay.
That will come in 12.2.
Okay, that's still coming. So here are all the external libraries. So for linear and for linear problems, we have CLP and CBC for mixed integer problems. Oops. For nonlinear problems, we have IPOPT, which we have also adapted for conic problems by pre-computing some of the derivatives, but it is still a nonlinear solver, so it's more efficient to use, for example, some of the semi-definite solvers, CSDP, DSDP, or the conic solver, SCS. And for each type of problem, we choose the solver by default, which is more efficient. So for linear problems, these are again CLP and CBC. For semi-definite problems, these are CSDP and DSDP. The default is CSDP. And for the future version, when MOSIC is available, it can be slightly more efficient in places where we use SCS by default, since SCS is a low accuracy library. So just, okay, I will, since. This is the only external commercial library that we have included so far, but we are going to include a plugin method for conic optimization that can facilitate including new libraries easily. And the way to do that is to write a library link and then a function that can interact with this library link and then register the new method in the following way. So I'll give an example. So for example, with MOSIC, we have two ways to solve a problem with MOSIC, one using the dual formulation and one using the primal formulation. And since the dual and primal conic optimization formulation and MOSIC and Mathematica are switched, if we want to solve the mixed integer problem, which MOSIC solves only for its primal problem, we need to transform our primal problem to their primal problem. And for this, we use MOSIC solve primal method. If we don't have a mixed integer problem, then we use MOSIC solve dual method because it's more efficient. It more directly matches our primal formulation. Okay, and then we need to specify the name of the function that we'll be using, what cons will be supported. So MOSIC supports all the cons that we have, and in what way it supports them. So the equality constraints, here there will be a part of these inequalities. The quality constraints will be supported as membership. This means X equal for example AX minus B equals 0. This means the AX minus B is an element of the zero cone, which is just the number 0. It's a border case of a cone. So the non-negative cone is supported as an affine function. Here AX plus, we have the affine inequalities AX plus B greater or equal than 0, for example. And for all the other cones, they will be supported as membership because we have that X is a member of a given cone. And we need to say if the library supports mixed integers or not. So that's how we can register new methods into conic optimization and new libraries. Okay, so just to wrap this up quickly, we talked about how we can model convex optimization problems into semi-definite and conic and use library solvers, which have been developed for many years and are quite efficient by now. So we have added new capabilities that include mixed integer problems, geometric optimization, new libraries, and new automatic transformations. And we'll be including MOSIC and this built-in method in a future version. Thank you.